Time having arrived, I call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to order. Ask you to please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Please be seated. So we usually open up our meetings with the hearing of visitors, opportunity for members of the public to come and address the school committee superintendent and mayor directly. In order to speak during hearing of visitors, you must sign up before the meeting starts. And we had no one sign in tonight requesting to speak. So that being the case, we'll go right on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is a block of routine business in front of the school committee that's considered as one item in order to keep the meeting moving along. However, any member of the school committee may request to have any individual item in the consent agenda removed for separate discussion. So at this time, I'll ask if any members of the school committee would like any of the items in the consent agenda removed for individual consideration.
Enough.
E and F. Mr. Minicello has E and F. Anyone else? Okay, so I'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda absent items E and F. Motion's made by Mr. Sullivan, seconded. All in favor? Approved unanimously. Mr. Minicello, E and F.
I just think it appropriate that we thank people when they make donations, and both of those items are basically donations made to the district. The first one is with respect to a fundraiser hosted by Brockton Uncorked. It was held on September 10th at the Enzo Gallery in Brockton. And from the proceeds of that fundraiser, the organization donated 8 Cape Verdean Creole to English dictionaries valued at $80 apiece. Courtesy of Millie Mila Publishing Company for the students of Brockton, and also made a $100 donation toward the Brockton Kids Count campaign. So these, I guess from what I'm reading, are the first ever Cape Verdean to Creole English dictionaries. So, oh, and Madam Superintendent has one to demonstrate, so that's nice.
I have to tell you, you know, we're so pleased as part of our campaign that people call up and say, you know, community organizations, we would like to do something to support our kids. We think it's a great campaign, which is what happened here. So, you know, we weren't sure, you know, what to expect when you say dictionaries, but there are 8 of them. This is just a beautiful book. The author is Manuel Gonzalez. I believe his daughter Liza organized this event, and we're very pleased that they thought of us. There are 8 of these dictionaries, and to look through them, I read the beginning part, and it talks about this is really part of the soul of the island of Cape Verde, and it really preserves all the wonderful people. It shows you, you know, pictures of the terrain and how people live. So with just 8 of these dictionaries, we are going to be giving them to the schools that have our SEI classes, the Brookfield, the Davis, the Huntington, Raymond, Northeast, and Brockton High School. In hopes that our students will take time to look through as they're learning the English language. So we really thank them, first of all, for being partners with us and for giving us something so worthwhile for the kids of our community to enjoy.
Great.
Yep.
Make a motion.
I was at the event. It was a great event. And I believe it's the first published Cape Verdean Creole dictionary. So, on that item, which one is that, Tom? E?
That is item E.
On item E, motion to approve.
Motion to approve.
Anybody? Okay, motion's made. Second. All in favor? Approved. Item F.
Second item is
a donation to the Davis School. The Danny Amendola Catches for Kids Foundation is donating a catch-a-book reading room at the Davis School. The donation is a result of a letter submitted to the foundation by grade 2 SEI teacher Bethany Johnson. The reading room will be located in a portion of the current library at the Davis. The donation includes installation of bookshelves, beanbags, book racks, and a mural, and also 600 books to fill the shelves. So obviously that adds up and is a very nice donation to the Davis community. So Again, just wanted to acknowledge the generous donation to, by the Danny Amendola Catches for Kids Foundation.
Yep. I think he's coming out to the school in a couple of weeks.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
And those kind of donations, again, are our teachers always are looking for grants, looking for donations, looking for, you know, certainly opportunities that fit into, you know, our strategic plan, supporting our students, supporting our families. So this is very exciting for the kids. And when you think about libraries of today, and we keep talking about, you know, digital media centers, but when you think about the comfort of the beanbag chairs, 600 books, you know, a comfortable place for kids to go and enjoy reading, you know, this will just be a beautiful addition, you know, to our Davis School library space and area. And thank you to the Patriots. They have been such wonderful partners. We know last year Malcolm Butler came out, you know, truly had an inspirational conversation with our students at West Middle School. And I'll remind you, that was a teacher reaching out about a program that caught their attention. So this is another wonderful thing. They're looking at communities that have Title I programs. This is one of our Title I schools. And they're truly looking to make sure that the support goes to children that truly are in need.
Okay. How about a motion?
Donation of the Danny Amendola Catches for Kids Foundation to the Davis School.
Motion's been made. Seconded. All in favor? Approved unanimously. All right, that takes care of the consent agenda, so we'll move on to the superintendent's report on teaching and learning.
And Mayor, I actually have, I never do, but I have communication tonight.
Wow.
So a letter came to our principal, Joanne Camillo, at the Barrett Russell School, and I ended up at a community event meeting the woman that authored this letter. Her name is Catherine Sardella. And Catherine and I had a conversation. She went to the old B.B. Russell School when it was an elementary school in the city. And she wanted an opportunity when she heard that it was brought back as a kindergarten center, you know, to go and visit and look at the school that she had attended many years ago. So she writes here, I don't want to read the whole letter, but she wants to thank Principal Camillo and her staff for the wonderful time she had at the Barrett B. Russell School's open house. From the moment I turned into the driveway, I was amazed at the outside transformation of the building and grounds. Absolutely beautiful. Once inside, I was awestruck as to the vivid and colorful hallways and classrooms, but more important than the overall general appearance of the school, it was the warm and friendly feeling I sensed from every staff member I met. So she goes on to talk about reminiscing about that school, but again, I think this is thanks to our facility department, the collaboration certainly with our city in bringing that back as a beautiful school and presently enjoyed as one of our kindergarten centers. So thank you to Catherine, and we're glad you were able to come and visit your alma mater. And now on to the report of the superintendent, and we do have our student representative, Somta Anabarg. Somta, take it away.
Next Tuesday, November 8th, is Election Day. There will be no school. Next Thursday, November 10th, is the Veterans Day Assembly at 9:30 p.m. The JRTC will be presenting a tribute to all veterans, and the school band will be doing a special performance of Inchon. On November 22nd, there will be a celebration for the 303 recipients of the John and Abigail Adams Scholarship at 9:30 a.m. Lastly, the National Honor Society is hosting its induction ceremony on the evening of November 29th.
Okay, and these events are just wonderful events. I know, Mayor, you'll join me about the Veterans Day celebration. It's really something that you know, if you haven't seen it, it's worthwhile, you know, taking the time. It honors our veterans, our people that serve in the military. Mayor, I know you brought your dad there.
He's planning on coming again this year. Yeah, he's a living World War II veteran. There aren't too many of them left, and he's planning on being there again this year.
It's emotional. The kids do such a wonderful tribute. If you can find the time to come to that, it is, as everything is here, it certainly is worthwhile. We look forward to, this time of year is a great time of year, you know, coming up to the high school, you know, the John and Abigail Adams Scholarship winners, our National Honor Society induction program. It's all about the instruction, the teaching, the learning, the scholarship, you know, the certainly the aptitude of what our students are able to perform. So we're very, very pleased, and congratulations to all our students and to our parents.
Okay.
We all set? All right, one of the things I had mentioned that I would continually do is the update of our charter school. And I'm calling it similar to our budget barometer. It is our budget barometer for the charter. So I will tell you that on September 1st, we had an enrollment of 220 students from the Brockton Public Schools. I want to clarify, those are the students I'm talking about, students that were enrolled in the Brockton Public Schools a year ago and have transferred to the charter. As of October 1st, there were 232. It is now down to 231 as of November 1st. And looking at the loss, the actual loss to our Chapter 70 funding, and we are held harmless for year one. But looking at this amount of money for next year would be just about $2 million. So we'll continue to keep count, and we'll have conversations about this. But I told you I would bring this to every school committee meeting. If there were issues to talk about, I would also share those with you. If there were building of collaboration, I will speak to you about that also. So I just will continue to update you, and if there are any questions that you would like me to look into, I'll be happy to do that. The other thing I want to talk about today was we were at Brockton High School today, and I want to remind some of our new school committee members that back actually before I became superintendent, when I came on board, there was already something called the District Capacity Project on board. And this was brought forward by former Superintendent Matt Malone, our school committee, and at the time our Brockton Education Association, where the three kind of branches of our government, you know, came together and decided on a project. And the project at the time was the dual language program that you have now instituted at the Raymond School. You brought Portuguese this year. Next year you're looking to bring on French, which honors the languages of a large majority of our students and families here in Brockton. And that's to join our Spanish dual enrollment program at the George School. And someday we're probably looking at an international school in our district, and it'll probably be one of its kind in the region. The project was a project that took a few years. There were a lot of visits to places that were similar. Many of us went on those visits. We sat, we looked at curriculum, designed the program, went back and forth with location, did surveys of parents. And one of the things you need when you do this is a facilitator. Somebody that makes sure that the work is moving forward, that helps with the communication, setting up the meetings, helping to research. The person that led that last time was Ray Shurtleff. Many of you probably had an opportunity to meet Ray. He's a retired school administrator, school principal. He's a college professor. And we have decided as a group that we will go forward with another district capacity project again with the three branches. I will be needing somebody or members from the school committee to be part of this. And this is going to be about our code of conduct district-wide. So today we actually started at the high school. Myself, Kim Gibson, Ray Shurtleff, we had two of the assistant deans, Tracy Chula Montero and Sean Desmond. Principal Wolder joined us for conversation before and after. And we were able to tour the high school and to actually look at the classes, to look at the instruction going on, to look at what's happening in the hallways, to talk about the floor teachers, to talk about the duties, to talk about substitute teachers, to talk about the overall climate. You know, we went from the gym through, you know, the core into many, many classes, over to the fine arts, and back to kind of debrief about what our next steps are. I'm very excited. Our next steps are on the 21st of November. We have Larry Derringer coming from Engaging Schools. And Larry was somebody I met last year at a superintendent conference with a similar project that had happened in Syracuse. I think I had talked to the committee about it at the time. So we're excited, and again, I always say that our high school is our flagship. We have 4,300 students up here. But this will be bringing the community together, looking at many of our faith-based groups, looking at our NAACP partners, looking at our district attorney, the sheriff's office, our parents, our students in the community, looking at elementary, middle, and high school, coming together and talking about the kind of school system that we want to put forward for our students and families, that we all agree on a code of conduct, that it's very clear to parents how we're working developmentally, and it's different at each level.
but that we're working together. There's continuity going from a young elementary school student to what's expected of a middle school student, and certainly where we end up in the citizens that we produce at the end with our students that graduate from Brockton High School. So I'm very pleased about this district capacity project. I do not anticipate it will happen overnight, but there will be research, there will be facilitation, and we will be able to look at possibly some other communities that have also delved into this, and I think this is very good for the Brockton Public Schools. I am going to need at some point looking for either a representative or two from our school committee. And I invite any of you to certainly take part, you know, in the process. So that's something that we can do at a later meeting if you would like to discuss it among yourselves.
We could nominate Brett. Teaching to miss a meeting.
I know. Okay, I'll move on to, I want to give you an update. Again, it was really very pleasing to be up at the high school today. Everything that we expect was going on, and you know, it was pretty much an unannounced visit as far as the students go. My favorite was we were looking at the procedure in the hallways. So when classes are going on, a student enters the hallway, and of course every student, I don't have it on right now, but has to be wearing their badge. And if you're going, you know, to the men's or ladies' room, if you're going to, you know, another classroom or down to the office, you know, you go with a slip and it explains, you know, to and from. So this poor young man, I think he was a freshman, was coming out of one of his classes to go to the men's room, and we stopped him. We were going through the protocol and talking about the procedure. So I'm sure he didn't appreciate five adults standing in front of him questioning his pass. But I will tell you, the kids
at least got him on the way back from the men's room.
That's right. But you know, we had great conversation. We were talking about the larger class sizes. We were talking about, again, excellent instruction. We were talking about directed academics and really looking to make sure that we can find ways to put computers in front of kids, laptops, laptop carts when they're taking their directed academics. There was a lot, and you know, again, it's not just about when you talk about a code of conduct, you know, it's not discipline. It's about, you know, how kids behave in school, you know, what kind of things they're able to do, how they can work together collaboratively, and it's all about developing our young people. And I'm telling you, you know, today walking around Brockton High School, looking at the work going on, the TV studio, the art classes, the digital photography, we were in every class, labs, social studies. You know, short of the numbers being larger than I would like, and I'll continue to say that to you. You know, our special needs youngsters, you know, integrated and involved in the climate and culture of our high school. I'm not saying that there isn't work to do, but I was very proud of things that we were seeing. And I bring that up because when I talk about a Brockton High School update, the things that we talked about bringing to the high school are additional substitute teachers, permanent substitutes, our behavioral support specialists, our teachers that are filling in if a substitute is needed, teaching elective classes. All of those things are happening. Those job ads have gone out. The principal is working to make sure those positions are filled. And I will tell you what a difference it made today. I did not see a lot of kids in the cafeteria. You know, the directed academics are what they are. But, you know, we saw kids engaged, halls orderly, floor teachers out there, teachers on duty. And this is continually something that we're working on. There are still some issues that we continue to work on here with implementing our contract and making sure our floor teachers also get the common planning time that other teachers have as bargained in the contract. So I'll continue to update that as we go forward. I also want to remind everybody that we did change the date of the middle school parent-teacher conferences because of that November 10th date, which that evening we had conferences scheduled. We have changed that. We will be getting word out again. We've sent a notification out to parents. We will be doing connected messages to them. It is a November 9th conference, afternoon and early evening, which is on the Wednesday. And I'm going to stop there because I know you're excited about the presentation happening from Dr. Cancel. So I'm going to invite Dr. Cancel up and Deputy Superintendent Barry. And you will hear about our accountability measures and the work we have ahead of us. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. If it were last night, we would have dressed for the occasion.
So, the 2016 MCAS and PARC results, I'm supposed to go quickly. So, we have four big things on the agenda. We have CPI that we're going to go over. That's the composite performance index, student growth percentile. We're going to go over the progress and performance index and the official accountability levels. So that's the agenda. Off we go. So just to begin with a review, understanding CPI, there are a lot of acronyms here, and we just want to be clear about things. The Composite Performance Index breaks down scores by performance level of the MCAS scaled score. If you scored advanced or proficient, in other words, your score was between a 240 or 280, you get 100 points. If you're in the high needs improvement category, that's between 230 and 238, you get 75 points. If you're in the low needs improvement category, you get 50 points. You get 25 points for being in the high warning failing category and 0 points for being in the low warning failing. The point about this slide in particular, people have pointed out to me, hey, Ethan, I thought we took PARC. Well, we did, except the state converts to an MCAS score so that you can get the performance levels for the CPI. The second thing about this, it's a very compressed scale at the top. There's no difference in the amount of points you get whether you score a 240, which is just making proficient, or a 280, which is a perfect score. It made a lot of sense back in the day when 93% of the 10th graders were failing math, so you could see movement at the lower end, but it does compress the top end. But that is what they use. It's CPI. How did we do? This is district-wide. ECPI stands for the English Language Arts portion. And you can see over this period, we've pretty much stayed flat. There's a little bit of a gain. And the big question is, how do you interpret this slide? So let me give you my interpretation, and we can discuss it later if you'd like. To me, the real thing is everyone, we should have 100% of our students being proficient. That's our goal, proficient or advanced. Being a high needs urban district, 75, which means you're at the high needs improvement, you're in striking distance of proficient, that to me is a reasonable level and a good level to be at. That would be a 75. So anything better than a 75, to me, that's a good benchmark to look at. That's a good score. Considering we had the Great Recession and we've had very tight budgets since then, the fact that the scores are going up, that's a good sign. They're not going up dramatically, but as our resources continue to be stretched thin and our need continues to increase, I would say that this is a positive slide. So that's the English CPI. That's our achievement in ELA across the district.
One second. So as Dr. Cancel goes through the district results, we're actually going to get down to the level of talking about elementary, middle school, and high school. But in the interest of time tonight, we are not going to go all the way down to the school level, and we're really going to be talking in general terms about some of the things that we're doing as a result of these scores. We will plan a presentation at a later date and involve folks from the learning and teaching team, as well as some folks from schools, to speak in more specific detail about what we're doing at each level. The other thing that I would point out, just while we're on district, looking at the district slides, the five-year trend that is illustrated is important to note, because in 2011-2012, that's when we were starting to implement new standards in ELA as well as math. So when you're looking at elementary results and when you're looking at middle school results, you want to keep that 2012 date in mind, because that's when the new standards came in.
All right, so on we go to the math. So the math tells a slightly different story. The 5 year is up, but you remember that we had that 75 as our sort of benchmark. This one's below it. It's good to see that it's gone up. It's gone up modestly. Same thing that we've talked about before. Difficult time. But you'll see throughout the night, I'm going to put a little focus and emphasis on the math and the science scores. So that's just a foreshadowing. Here we go with the science. We're down a little bit, we're up a little bit. To me, these are flat scores. And when we break it down at the different grade levels, which we're going to go into next, you'll see that there's a slightly different story going on. There's one other thing that I have to say now, because I haven't said it to begin, but I should have. This is a very difficult time to do data analysis and to draw big conclusions because we're in a state of transition. We went from MCAS to PARC. Some of our schools are taking PARC online. Some of our schools are taking it paper and pencil. Across the state, some districts decided they'll stay with MCAS. Others decided they'd go PARC, all online, all paper. There have been substantial differences between. There have been substantial challenges the state faced trying to convert things. So that's just a caveat to take all of these scores with a, just realizing that there's a decent amount of error and this is a time of transition. So the state recognized that and is officially holding everyone harmless. So that's just another thing. I should have led with that, but it's just to sort of layer on top. That doesn't mean that these scores, you can't trust them. These, when the beauty of statistics, when the numbers get larger, the statistics are more accurate. We're a large district, it's decent.
And just while we're on science and talking about transition, when we're looking at 2015 to 2016, the other thing that's important to keep in mind at the state level is in 2015, the Massachusetts adopted the Massachusetts version of the Next Generation Science Standards. So in 2015 to 2016, we are working towards implementing those new standards. So we have new standards in ELA and math starting in 2012, and then 2015, we have new standards at the state level in the area of science. So lots going on at the state level, just to keep in mind as you're looking at this. Thank you.
So back we go to, we get down a little deeper because there are differences when you go down among the levels. So this is the 3 through 5 ELA, this is the CPI. And again, remember we always say that 75. That's where we want to be. The good news on this slide is we're modestly getting better. That is a positive. The bad news is it's below the 75. Okay, we'll see more of these sorts of slides because we take them in conjunction with the growth. This slide is interesting. It's one of the more interesting slides of the deck because in Brockton, ELA is always higher than math. In this one, at the elementary level, math has gone up and it's gone up nicely. It's also higher. It's still below the 75 where we want to be, but it's higher than the ELA. So this is an interesting slide. And it should predict positive things moving forward as those students move on to middle school and high school. Science, however, is the one that did not go up and needs to be an area of focus. It's lower. This is common across the state, especially among urbans. But this is an area where if the students are doing pretty well in ELA, they're doing pretty well in math, the science should be similar and it's a little dissimilar. So this is you know, with the brand new standards in place and other things, this is an area that we have to pay some attention to. So now the 6 through 8 tells a different story. You see that they're substantially above that 75 threshold in ELA. And you see that there's, you know, modest growth and or improvement, I should say. And that's a good thing considering the challenges during this time. However, on this side, you see that there's the largest gap between any of the grade bands, between the ELA and the math. In terms of the math, it was flat and it's up, you know, a teeny tiny bit, but it's basically a flat slide. It's interesting, the ELA is really strong and the math isn't. And then the science, if the math wasn't really strong, okay, it's flat, the science is actually down a little bit. not down terribly, but it's again, that needs to be an area of focus for us going forwards, that 54 is a low score. That's not uncommon for urban districts, but our goal is to be the top urban district. And so that's an area where if we do better, it will give us benefits across the accountability system. Grade 10, very interesting story. It's just a terrific story of success. This is all grade 10 students. That's mostly Brockton High School, but they're also the alternative schools as well. And you see, you can say, well, Ethan, you're kind of flat. Well, you're also hitting the ceiling. 100 is proficient or advanced. You've got almost everyone in the city, not just Brockton High School, in the city, scoring proficient. So that's a great slide. The math is not as good. Again, this is not a terrible slide. It's above the 75, but you see that it's a flat or down trend, and it's not as good as the potential of our students or our teachers, and you can see that. The science is actually bucking the rest of the district's science trend. So the science department actually has some success at the high school that we don't see at the other grades. So that's going to be interesting going forward. Now we're going to shift gears and we're going to go into the student growth percentile. I'm going to go over the definition. It's a very slippery concept. One of the big terms is academic peer group. And amazingly, none of the I don't know what happened, but all the words are missing. So I can tell you what the academic peer group is. The academic peer group are students who share an academic history. The other slide would talk about percentiles. And the percentiles would be the big point here is the state says between 40 and 60 is good. And the other thing, just for a definition, if you have the if you score in the 70th percentile, that means you're scoring better than 70% of the people who took the test. I hope that doesn't happen to all of my animations, by the way.
That's what you get for being fancy.
No, it's what I get for the new computer. So here's, it's hard to explain. Yep. All the animations are gone. That's terrific. So we have three different students. They all have a different academic peer group. They all have a different score history. The first group of students would be in a group that has scored 230 in third grade, 236 in fourth grade. So that's that group. The second student is in the 268-268 group. And the third student is in the 214-214 group. So each of those students is in their own academic peer group. They then take the test in 2016 in fifth grade. You take that 232 of the first student and you rank order all the scores of students in their academic peer group. So all those kids with the 230-236, you rank order, where does the 232 fit? And lo and behold, it's in the 40th percentile. You do the same thing with the second student, and lo and behold, they're in the 25th percentile, and the third student is in the 72nd. Now, the reason why I put this slide up, it shows that it doesn't matter if you're a high-scoring student, a low-scoring student, a middle-scoring student. It doesn't matter what your scores are. What matters is how you improve compared to students with a similar score history. That means you can be the top scoring student in the state, you can be the bottom, you can be in the middle. If you're doing better than students with similar score histories, you're being pushed hard and you're doing well. If you're not, you're not, and it's going to show up in the student growth percentile. Ah! Some of them did show up. It's sort of random. So having said all of that, the student growth percentile for ELA, between 40, how do you interpret this slide? You can take a look, oh, you know, we've gone down, we've gone up. That's not as important. Between 40 and 60 is good. 54 is on the positive side of good. So this is really nice, solid growth. That's for the entire district in ELA. So that's, I would say that's a nice slide. This slide, you can say at first, you know, we see the arrows going down and it looks like it's going down a lot. Remember, it's between 40 and 60. Between 40 and 60 is good, 45 is in the middle. The thing that is a little bit concerning is that you see 3 years going down, but it's still in the good category. But the point of this is, I said that math and science were areas of focus. The ELA growth, the typical growth for students, is stronger than in math. It's not bad in math, but it's stronger in ELA. So how does it break out at the different grade levels? So we saw that the elementary grades had nice improvement, but they were, relatively speaking, compared to our other grades, scoring low. Their growth is decent. 46 is decent. It's not out of the park good, but it is definitely in the good category. So that's the growth. You can see those scores. This one's a little more interesting. And again, although I put in the calculations, the thing that's important, it still is in the 40 to 60, although 43 is beginning to get to the lower end of the 40-60 good band. But what we see is what the Wall Street guys would call, you see lower lows and lower highs. And that generally speaks to a downward trend. So again, solid growth, but not great growth. This is very, very solid growth. This is better than solid growth. This is very good growth. So solidly above, you know, above 50, once you're, you know, in the 60s, 58 is very close, that's a nice thing. So we saw the ELA, the score was high, the CPI score was high, and the growth is high at the middle grades. And you can look at these numbers are less important because the scores tend to jump around a little bit year to year. The math is still solid, but you can see the difference. Same students, sixth grade through eighth grade students, decent, not bad, but not as strong. And you can see those. So now 10th grade, these are terrific. It's hard to, you know, say, 61, that's terrific. 61 is terrific. Very few schools have a median, or very few districts have a median at the 10th grade of 61. That's just terrific growth. So the ELA, it's strong throughout. It's not a big deal that it's, you know, down from the 73. That's outrageous, or the 69. Anything between 40 and 60 is good. 61 is obviously better than that. Math is solid, nothing wrong with it, but it's not that same sensational chart. But there is nothing wrong with that chart. That's very solid. So, accountability. This is very confusing. I'm going to go over it quickly because I think you don't need to bog down in the weeds. The bottom line here is there are three main things that they look at when they calculate accountability. They look at proficiency gap narrowing, they look at the student growth percentile, and they look at the bonus points. Proficiency gap narrowing means this. They want you to be at 100%. 100% students proficient or advanced, so they'd like 100 for your CPI. But they say, you know what? Back in 2011, that will be your baseline. Where you start, we want you to cut the distance between where you are and 100 in half. So if you were at a 75 back in 2011, they want you to cut the distance between 75 and 100, 25 points in half, that'd be 12 and a half points. And then you have 6 years to make up those 12 and a half points. So roughly speaking, 2 points a year. It's relentless. Every year you have to make it. If you don't, you have to make it up the next year. It's a pretty tough measure. Student growth percentile, we just went over it. And bonus points, they give you bonus points for increasing your percentage of students scoring advanced, decreasing the percentage who are scoring warning. They give you bonus points for your WIDA access scores. So there are a bunch of different bonus points, and those are key. Here we have, it's very complicated. They really went out of their way to make the most difficult index imaginable. They don't just stop there. They say there's an annual PPI and there's a four-year. The four-year is what's needed for accountability status. It's a weighted average. It counts most the most recent year, and the least is for the fourth year. The points are interesting because 75 points are given if you're on target. Usually you think of 100 being a good score. In this one, 75 is a good score. So if you're at 50, it means you're improving. But like in our example where you had to improve those 2 points every year, let's say you missed it for 2 years and then 1 year you improved 4 points. You improved, you just improved below the target. And you get 100 points for being above target, you get nothing if you decline, you get 25 points if you change. So, cut to the chase, how do we do? 50, we improved, and again, the targets keep getting harder, and the economy and the budget has not really gotten better for us. So, to me, improvement, not a bad story. We're flat, you know, we're down a little bit from where we started, but this is a measure that jumps around, especially when you have things like a new test, which came in 2015. So that to me is a decent chart, not great. This one shows, the pink shows you the annual PPI, that was the PPI for last year, and the percentiles. The state law says you have to calculate the percentiles. They compare every school compared to schools in the same grade band. So the Kennedy School is an elementary school. It's gonna be compared to all of the different elementary schools. And I looked it up for you just so you know, there were 808 roughly elementary schools. The Davis School is a K through eight, so it's gonna be compared to the 114 K through eights. East is a middle school. There were 287 middle schools, and the high school or Edison, 259 high schools. So you see the yellow number is the percentile. That's how it compares to every other school of that grade band. And then the number on top of the pink is the annual PPI, which says, did you make your targets? And I want to call out, if you remember, 75 was making your target. So anything better than 75 on that top is good. So East at an 80 means that they're doing better than making their targets. Or Huntington at an 85, or Brockton High at an 86, or Ashfield Middle School at a 90, North at a 95, and the outrageous score of 120. Raymond made every one of its targets. It made all kinds of bonus points. It had a very, very good year. It had a big year of improvement. Their scores may not be that high compared to some others, but their improvement was great. So that's what that chart's about. So we jump for joy there. That's my bad joke of the day. Thank you for the laugh. Can count on you for that one. All right. Coming close to the finish line here. This is a chart that shows the state's accountability levels. Just to confuse everyone, Park had levels 1 through 5, 1 being bad, 5 being good. The state has 1 through 5, 1 being good, 5 being bad. The state at least can say we did it first. So level 3 is the big cut. Back to those percentiles, which is why I gave them to you guys. If you're in the bottom 20%, by definition, doesn't matter how much you improve, you're a level 3 school. It may or may not be a fair comparison to compare an urban school to a wealthy suburban school. That's the way it is. If you're in the bottom 20%, you're at least a level 3 school. The ESE, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, is very involved with what you do. Level 4 is the lowest performing subset of level 3, and it's even higher in terms of the involvement by the ESE. I was polite and said engagement, but they come in hard with a level 4 school. We've never had a level 4 school. And then level 5 is when the state actually takes you over. You're labeled a chronically underperforming school or district, and it's extremely high. It's a takeover. Level two, when you're in that top 80, if you don't make your PPI, but you are not in the bottom 20, you end up as a level two school. Low engagement. Level one is you're not in the bottom 20. And by the way, you made your targets, which now is getting very difficult to do. And then there are commendation schools, which are a subset of level one, and there are very, very few of them. I want to go through this because this, I think, is a very uplifting, impressive graphic. Not my design, but the content. It's another joke. You got it.
Okay. I think it's funny.
Poor Tom.
You put up with a lot of these.
So what's the big takeaway? Level one schools, this is the number of level ones, level twos, and level three schools. The point here that's so impressive is, in a very difficult time, the number of level four schools has increased. Sal will tell us that they've increased infinitely, because from zero to anything is an infinite increase, but that's a huge increase. Level two schools, while you say, oh, well, they've gone down, level one and level two, that's the cut. You either make the bottom or you're above the bottom 20 or you're not. So it's good when you add the two up, where we have nine schools now, level one or level two. Back in 2014, we had seven. So that's good. And our level three schools, we're reducing the number to nine. And what's really fantastic, we're the only large urban district that can say this, we do not have a level four school. And I cannot tell you how difficult it is to be a large district and not have a single school in level four. So this to me is quite a testament to the hard work that the people at the schools do. And that's a school that Brockton, that's a chart that Brockton as a community should be very proud of. So then I just wanted to go through the schools. The level two schools, Asheville Middle School, Angelo Davis, Pliff Academy, and West. And level one this year, we've got four of them. Brockton High regains their level one status. East maintains it. Kennedy maintains it. North gains it. I want to point out something else. There was a hold harmless provision that I talked about. Brockton did not use the hold harmless provision in the sense that hold harmless means you can only improve, you can't do worse. If you had been a level one school and you did terribly, now you're a level three school, which does happen, you would be held harmless. It'd be level one held harmless. If you go through the official page, you don't see any held harmless signs there. The things that Brockton has earned, Brockton has earned. There were no gimmies. So good job to the schools. And now, bringing back Clippy, my friend, any questions? Thank you. It's actually research-based. Apparently, people really are fond of failed Microsoft products. I tried it, really looked it up.
That's great, thank you.
Ethan, you've said it over the years that you know, the longer a student is in the Brockton Public Schools, the better they do. And I think that when you look at the data with regard to the 10th grade results, it certainly, you know, holds true. Can you just elaborate a little bit on that point?
Yeah, it's really a testament to something that we've talked about a lot, which is the longer you're in Brockton, the better you do. And so by the time you look at students who have been in from third grade, not even kindergarten, third grade to 10th grade, our scores mirror or beat the state. And so we're a gateway city. We take all kinds of students all the time. There's a lot of motion in and out of the district. But if you're able to stay here and you're able to get, you know, the continuity year to year, you do fantastically well. And that's, if we could be judged on that, it would be really, you know, that would be more fair, but we're judged how we're judged. But that is a testament to the work that the people do in the schools.
I think that's a very valid point. You know, at the younger grades, you know, we have a lot of kids, like you said, that come from different places. They could come from Boston. They could come from, you know,
Florida.
Yeah, you know, other countries. They can come from other states. They can come from other parts of this state. I mean, you know, it's not like when we grew up here in Brockton, where, you know, there wasn't a lot of move. You know, people moved, but it wasn't as much. You know what I mean? It just wasn't anywhere near the degree that it is today in terms of, you know, we see we have a, you know, a large homeless population. You know, and again, if, when you look at our population with regard to English language learners, that also tells you the story that, you know, these students and children are coming from, you know, different countries. So, you know, you can certainly understand, you know, the story that our numbers seem to tell. But I mean, it is a great sign, and it is a good testament to the hard work that, you know, we're level and or moving up. And the fact that we don't have a level four is great. And the fact that we're putting more schools into the one and two column, that's great work too. So, that being said, I would like to just compliment and let the people in the district know that the hard work they're doing is certainly, you know, being noticed and appearing in our numbers. So,
and I think another point, Mr. Minicello, is we don't make excuses here. You know, we're dealing with some very difficult budgets. You heard me talking about the teaching and learning today at the high school, but the classes are large. You know, that is going to have an impact. We're making decisions about curriculum as the standards have changed. We've waited to decide on, you know, digital textbooks, and we continue to do those things. But we're looking at curriculum. We're looking at ways to support intervention, you know, programs that we'd like to bring district-wide at the different levels. So we are going to present to you, you know, this isn't the end of the story. You know, we'd like teaching and learning to come forward and talk about some of the very things and the work that is going on at every one of the levels. And it really does have implications for our budget. And you know, we know what's ahead for us, but we have to make sure that in order to support our number one mission, you know, which is our instruction of our students. And it's interesting because this time of year you read about, you know, accountability is going on throughout the state and sharing, but this is a good news story. And I appreciate your commenting on, you know, the very people that are there working with these kids day in and day out, and I'll make sure a message, you know, gets out to them. But we've got a lot of hard work ahead of us.
Lisa? I got to see this year a PARC test score and an EBCAS test score due to the ages of my children. Oh, okay. And I was thinking, for one, maybe it would be beneficial to the whole committee if they saw some kind of sample testing. I think it just gives me a good idea of what we're talking about here. One difference I noticed is on the MCAS, there's a lot of information, maybe even some of it confusing, but there's a lot of information when you are looking at a student's MCAS test results. Mm-hmm. On the PARC, I have to say, it was easier to read, but I almost felt like maybe it was lacking. There definitely wasn't as much information. And is that perhaps maybe just because we have not been doing PARC for long? Do you think that, you know, obviously, how much information is going to be on a test when it's new anyway, as in yearly comparisons?
You're talking about the parent report that you received?
Yes, the parent
having
report.
Kids taking two tests.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, no, the PARC's over, basically. We're moving on to MCAS 2.0 or next generation. But you're absolutely right. One of the reasons why it was a test drive, they really didn't know how the test was going to perform. They didn't have the sort of history with MCAS. They didn't have a similar sort of history like we have with MCAS. Items weren't able to be released for that reason. That's why we talk about this period of transition. I'd love to be able to tell you what's going to happen with MCAS 2.0 or the next generation. It's a work in progress. We will see. But eventually, we will be with the next generation where we were with the current, you know, MCAS. The data is much richer. You can dig into it and get much more meaningful information from it. Since we have that history, I don't see why that would go away.
for instance, on the MCAS, you can see your students, how, you know, they might have answered 40 questions, and you
yep.
see which ones are correct, which ones
That's
are wrong.
Right.
On an open response, it's scored
yep.
0 out of 4.
Yep.
But we don't know if you'll see that kind of information on the new test, the next generation test.
Right. We hope to. I think
most
the thing,
likely eventually.
And your example of having two children and having them take a different test, I think, speaks to what is happening at the state level. This is the first year in a while that usually these presentations, they go on a lot longer. And we have a state comparison. And this is the first year where, because districts across the state are taking different assessments, we don't have that, here's how Brockton did
That's right.
in relation to the state. So we're lacking that information because we're all taking different assessments, which obviously is going to change. But it is it's a tenuous time, you know, when we're talking about standards changing, and we thought we were sort of starting to stabilize, and the state was reaching a point where where the standards were at a point where we could start to think about print resources and things like that. And just this week we received notification that they're making changes to the learning standards in math and ELA, and that they are actually going out to comment. And so we're expecting additional revisions to those standards that changed in 2011, 2012. So it's a difficult time because it's a moving target. The assessment's changing, the standards are changing, and we hope that stabilizes soon. Because I know, even looking at the state versus Brockton, that was really helpful information
right.
for us to have that we no longer have. And so you're feeling that at a parent level, and we're feeling that at the district level. There are just pieces missing because we're all on different trajectories, at least right now.
That was the teacher's favorite report.
They did.
The first thing they said is, I want to do the item analysis where, you know, you take a look at how your kid did or your kids did versus the state, and you were able to see the differences. It was really good for curriculum. You could say, oh, we see we have, you know, the biggest gap is here, so we need to, you know, check out our curriculum on that topic. You can't do that with Park. That's not terrible. The thing is that when we went through this with MCAS back in the 90s, we didn't have an accountability system. The state recognizes that. There are laws that are sort of tying their hands, so they're holding people harmless. They're recalculating. Sometimes they include 2015 data. If you're harmed by that, they take it out. So they calculate it two different ways. But your insight is one that's going on across the state, and I wish I could tell you exactly what the next generation looks like. I don't know yet.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Mr. Sullivan. That PowerPoint was fabulous. the length of time was great, too.
How about the jokes?
And the jokes. And some of the computer remarks were nice. But I wanted to congratulate the teachers,
absolutely,
all the administration for doing one heck of a job to produce something like this. And I just had one question, because you mentioned it two or three times about the economy and the budget. What does that have to do with this PowerPoint?
Oh,
in other words, do we have larger classroom sizes or lack
sure.
of teachers? Or
sure. Yeah, you've heard the superintendent talk about this a lot. The difference between where we are and the most affluent districts who are spending the most per capita has been growing and growing. The whole point of ed reform was to not totally eliminate those disparities, but to make the gap reasonable so everyone had a fighting chance. So it was more of an NFL model of parity rather than the baseball, where, you know, you have the Yankees and the Red Sox and everyone else is really struggling. So we don't have the money to resource our schools appropriately. That to me is just a fact. When you have class sizes that the superintendent talks about in Brockton versus what her colleagues in the neighboring suburbs are talking about, that's just eye-opening when you realize that you don't have the supports you know, there are these great programs that June or Cliff or Liz, and you know, they just want to purchase these great programs. They're going to be fabulous for our kids, and you can't because the cost is prohibitive. And I'll let the superintendent talk about the budget.
Tampa Bay Rays, so you know me, I want to be the Boston Red Sox guys. So I thought that was a really good comparison, and you know, we have certainly talked about equity in education. We met with our legislative delegation probably about two months ago now, I want to say, maybe at the beginning of school, and we are starting to have conversations about looking into equity in education lawsuits, looking for attorneys willing to come on board and take a look at the inequities that we're facing. Not only do we have students many times brand new to the country, you know, a little five-year-old, you know, learning to speak the language, and our classes in our kindergartens, you go to your surrounding towns, and again, there are 15 to 18 kids in a kindergarten class, and they're coming from families that look very different than some of our families. You know, able to support, able to purchase books and laptops and computers and museum visits and vacations and all those things that build language and build skills. And we're able to do that. But we have kindergarten classes that when a child moves in, there are 24 and 25 kids in a kid. That's to start. You know, these are some of the discussions that we'll continue to have, is that equity in education. When you heard me talk about the high school today, you have excellent teaching going on. And we're working as hard as we can to develop common planning time and to look at lessons and to look at how our students are achieving, where are they struggling, how can we support them. We're looking to do all those things, but when you again have, and every class I went into today, I would spend time counting. There were some classes with 30 kids. There can be great teaching going on, but what about those kids that need some kind of intervention or aren't quite getting it or need the teacher's support? And it's not that the teachers aren't there, but 30 kids versus kids, 15 to 20 kids in a class makes a whole lot of difference. So it's not that we're making excuses. Our budget is what it is. We're a large urban center. We do the very best that we can, and we have wonderful things, you know, happening for our students. But it's becoming more and more difficult, and we're just going to have to really concentrate our resources in ways that we're getting, I don't want to say the biggest bang for the buck, because that's not a phrase to use when you're talking about education. Because it makes a difference for a student whether they're getting those AP classes, IB classes, or those students that are struggling and maybe need smaller classes with interventions. So, you know, we're looking at, and it's very sad when I look and say, okay, what are the superintendent focus schools this year? You know, most schools need the superintendent, meaning our school committee, you know, our focus in how we're going to support them. So, you know, we're a district where we look at the ones that are struggling the most. And it's easy to see where those schools are. And, you know, we're trying to find ways, can we cap classes? That's not working. Not where people are moving in, not, you know, the kind of neighborhoods that we have. I looked at our numbers today. We are 139 down from where we were a year ago. You look around you at all the towns, demographically, numbers are down. You know, 139, I think, is the difference from this year to last year. But when you look at, you just heard me talk about the number 231, I think, that we've actually lost, you know, to a charter. That tells me our numbers are really up still. So, you know, we continue to work. And I think, Mr. Sullivan, I think when we have that presentation from teaching and learning and you hear us talk about those areas that we think we're making inroads and what we need to do to continue to make those inroads, I think it'll become a little bit clearer as to the battle we're kind of fighting.
Yeah, I think we'll be able to talk about the intentional decisions that we're making in regards to resources and professional development based on areas of weakness that we see. So.
Nice job. Thank you.
Who else? No? Ethan, Liz, thank you very much. Great presentation.
Thank you.
A lot of good news in there.
Yeah. Level one, four level one schools,
four level
guys.
Level one schools. And no level fours.
No, and your high school is level one. I mean, that is, I agree. Let's come on. Thank you. Okay, let me finish up. I have a couple of things. One, I do want to make note, and I can't tell you that we've even had a chance to really discuss this. you know, my heart goes out to the young girl, a 9-year-old girl in the community of Plainville, getting off the bus. And what we're hearing, I actually got a note from the superintendent of, I think it's Mohawk Valley. And what they were saying is, and we need to get a message out certainly to our bus drivers, is what happened was the little girl's backpack got caught in the door. The backpack when you're getting off the bus. And the bus, you know, left. The little girl's father and brother were standing there waiting for the child to get off the bus. So these are things that we will make sure we're sharing with our bus drivers. You know, make sure visibly that those kids are off the bus and everything attached to them is off the bus before leaving. I mean, it's just a tragic accident. But again, those are things that I think all of us, and when you're talking to your children, you know, make sure that those backpacks are secured with them, not hanging off, and they're actually very careful getting off the buses. I also want to send out a thank you to Dan and Angela Henry. Dan and Angela Henry are our neighbors in Easton, and tragically back in 2010, their son, DJ, Dan Roy, was killed. He was a student at Pace University. I think you probably all read the article at the time. He was a young man that played football for all of Rames, went on to play football at Pace, you know, was killed during a senseless shooting. And when you look at Dan and Angela 6 years later, talk about just two classy people who have taken tragedy in their family and have built it into something positive for youngsters. I had the opportunity to go Saturday night to the gala. I actually serve on that board of directors. And it was talked about Mayor. I want to say Mayor Carpenter did an excellent job Saturday night. He was video conferenced in along with a number of other elected officials, Senator Elizabeth Warren, Mayor Marty Walsh, your Governor Baker, you know, talking about what this family is doing for kids. And it's the power of saying yes. And it's something simple as a scholarship for students that might not be able to take part in a cheerleading activity, a football activity, anything that makes a child's dream come true. And they have benefited 7,000 students. And I want you to know, they talked about, I was the director of community schools at the time, and whoever comes knocking at your door, I did not know this family, it was a year after the incident, and they came and said, we have $1,000 to give out, we want to give scholarships to Brockton kids. So we were their first charity. They continue to support our children and many children throughout the state. And I just want to thank them for everything that they have done. And the DJ Dream Fund will live on in the lives of so many of our children. So thank you to Dan and Angela.
Yeah, I regret I couldn't be there in person this year, but I attend most of their events and they do incredible
stuff. You did a good job. You were on the big screen.
On video, yeah. It was beautiful. 85% of the money that they donate to kids goes to Brockton kids, 85%.
Yeah. And I want to finish up, you know, we had an incident that happened at Brockton High School, and I want to make it clear that we certainly are not a district that tries to protect the image of our district. Our district is what it is. I'm proud of our district each and every day. But I do want to make a statement. And my statement is this. I want to thank our teachers and administrators at Brockton High School for acting swiftly in their professional capacity in supporting our student victim and alerting our school and Brockton police as to information that had been reported to them, as they are mandated reporters. As a district, we protect the confidentiality of our student victim and work closely with the police during an active investigation and the consequent arrest of a perpetrator. During the course of this active investigation and based on the information we received from law enforcement, there was no threat to any other students at the time or any other members in our community. The timing of the announcement to our Brockton High School parents from Principal Wolder was sent once we had enough facts to make a responsible announcement with the information needed from our law enforcement. I want to thank Mayor Carpenter, Chief Crowley, our Brockton and school police for working diligently to make sure this situation was fully investigated and arrest was brought forward. I think parents here know, I have lived in this community for over 30 years. My children attended the Brockton Public Schools. The number one concern that we have each and every day is the safety and security of your children. We work very closely with you. If there's information to share, we share it in a responsible manner when we're able to do that, not get in the way of investigations, and work cooperatively with so many people as this instance is. And again, I want to make that clear. I want to thank the parents. I know there was a lot of support from our parents out there, and know that their children is attending a wonderful institution here in Brockton that brings so much pride, you know, to our community. In fact, parents, we continue to work with you as partners. I do ask you to watch carefully with your children's social media. Make sure that you're on top of everything that is happening, you know, with your children. This is obviously a very different world that we're all living in right now. And again, I want to thank everybody that worked together this weekend to help us bring this to a quick conclusion.
I think people have to realize that when there's an instance like this, what we know 3 days later is not what we know when it's first reported. And when things are first coming in, the police are actively investigating. So there's been a report of something. Sometimes there are reports that the investigation finds are not accurate. Sometimes there are things on social media that are wildly inaccurate. So I think that the response of the administrators, school police, Brockton police, was fast, it was immediate. Investigation was launched right away. It was clear to me that the school administrators and counselors immediately were attending to the needs of the victim and making sure that the person was protected and supported. And at the same time, the police had a very active investigation going on. And I think, as the superintendent alluded to in her statement, as the investigation proceeded, it became clear that the circumstances, as we learned circumstances around this, that there was no threat to any other student at any point, at any time on the campus. That we knew that the suspect who was later charged was out of the area, that the people involved knew each other, and this was something that had initiated outside of school. There was just no risk to any other student. There was no ongoing threat of any type. So I think, you know, it's a really tough call for the superintendent as to what you release and what you don't release. And I think it was right to protect a victim of this type of crime has got to be the primary concern if there's no threat. I think if for a second the superintendent or I had believed that there was any potential threat to any other student, then there would have been information out so that parents could make decisions and take appropriate steps. But that just wasn't the case here. And I think it was handled very responsibly. Everybody filled their roles, from the teachers and counselors, administrators, law enforcement, and every situation is different, but this one didn't warrant any type of immediate warning because there was no ongoing threat of any type, and that was established very early on. So there were a lot of people working very hard behind the scenes. But at that point, I supported the superintendent's decision to hold back on a public statement at that time until we felt the time was appropriate. And the time that was appropriate was when an arrest had been made, a person was in custody, and the facts were much more clearly understood. Better to get it right and better to protect the victim. I think that's what was done. Okay.
All set.
Okay. All right. We'll move on to new business. I know Mr. Sullivan would like the floor for a minute because one of his schools, the Matt George School PTA, has a fundraiser coming up with the Harlem Wizards that he'd like to give a plug for. So, Mr. Sullivan, the floor is yours.
Thank you. And I'll make it as fast as I can. I know you're in a rush.
Not that much of a rush.
The Harlem Wizards are back versus your teachers. The Harlem Wizards versus the Brockton Bolts, featuring the teachers and administrators of Brockton Public Schools. The venue is going to be at Brockton High School. The host school is the Mathalia George Elementary School and PTA. The date is Saturday, November 12th, 2016. Game time, 7 p.m., doors open at 6. Advance tickets for students are $10, general admission, $12. Tickets at the door, students, $12, general admission is $14. You'll get your tickets early. Reserved is $20, courtside is $30. Tickets are on sale at www.georgeschoolpta.org. Souvenirs for the game will be on sale at the game. And this is brought to you by Mike Henry, the president of the Matt George PTA.
What's the date and time again, Tim?
The date is Saturday, November 12th at 7 p.m.
Okay. All right, so we hope that some families will be able to get out and enjoy the event and support the PTA at the George School at the same time. Thank you, Tim.
Yeah, great time.
All right, so we do have a couple reports we have to do from subcommittees that met earlier this evening, and Mr. Sullivan, seeing as we'll just keep you right up. The bid review subcommittee meeting met earlier this evening.
Yes, a meeting was held tonight for the bid review subcommittee of the Brockton High School. It was scheduled for tonight at 6 p.m. right here in the Little Ron Theater, Brockton High School. Give me 1 second. Here we go. Okay, president was myself, Tim Sullivan from Ward 7 as the chair, Ms. Joyce Azaka from Ward 6, Mr. Mark D'Agostino from Ward 3. The meeting was called to order at 6:15. After discussion of the fiscal year 2017 number 2 electrical services bid, a motion was made by Joyce Azak to accept the bids as presented, which I might add was a low bid. A motion was seconded by Mark D'Agostino. The vote was unanimous. After discussion again, fiscal year 2017, item number 2, refrigeration and air conditioning service bid. A motion was made by Mark D'Agostino, seconded by Joyce Azaka. That vote was also unanimous. The meeting moved to adjourn at 6:25. Do you need this motion right off?
Okay, so I think we probably need one vote to accept the report, and then a second vote to approve the awarding of the bids as you described. Should we do separate for each bid, you think? Okay. So, first one will be a motion to accept the report as presented from the subcommittee.
I'll make the motion to accept the report of the subcommittee as presented.
Okay. Second. Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor? That's approved. The first bid again, Tim, just describe it briefly.
The first bid was fiscal year 2017 electrical services bid.
Awarded,
and it went to the low bidder. The low bidder was, where the heck is it?
I think if we're gonna approve it publicly, we should probably make sure we're disclosing who the bidder was that's getting the contract. Sorry, Tim, didn't mean to throw you a curve.
A little curve. Who was that, Joyce?
I right
there. Not that one, that's the electrical.
Mechanical.
The electrical.
That's refrigeration.
Which? Oh, here it is. The low bidder was Gone Green Electric from 2 Rockview Way, Unit 3, Rockland, Mass.
Okay, so now motion's been made to approve the bid as described by Mr. Sullivan. Do I have a second on the motion?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. D'Agostino. All in favor? Okay, so the electrical award of the electrical bid is approved. And then just briefly describe the other one, Tim.
The second bid was for HVAC, which would be the on-call services Monday through Friday and weekends. It was awarded to the present CAM HVAC and construction of Smithfield, Rhode Island at $94.45 per hour. There was only one other bid which was rejected because they did not submit at least 5 licensed technicians on staff to go along with the bid.
Okay, So I'll take that in the form of a motion. Motion to approve the awarding of the HVAC maintenance contract as described by Mr. Sullivan. Second. Mr. D'Agostino, thank you for the second. All in favor? Approved. Okay. Thank you very much. And then, Tom, you're chair of finance. The finance subcommittee also met earlier this evening.
The finance subcommittee met this evening at approximately 6:30 to discuss a few issues that survived the certified negotiations with the BEA. A joint task force was put together to discuss and review three items, the first item being the status of BEA members who hold a Juris Doctor degree with respect to the salary for said position in Appendix A of the contract. Second item was the position of school nurse with respect to a differential schedule in Appendix E of the contract. And the third item was the boys and girls tennis coach positions with respect to their compensation in relation to all of the other spring coaches as illustrated in Appendix B of the contract. At that meeting, it was voted by the Finance Subcommittee meeting, Finance Subcommittee, which is subcommittee of the whole, to favorably approve the recommendations. That is essentially the goings-on of the Finance Subcommittee this evening. So I would present a motion to approve the report of the Finance Subcommittee meeting of this evening.
Okay, so the first motion by Mr. Minichiello is to accept the report as presented of the Finance Subcommittee.
Second.
Second by Mr. Sullivan. All in favor? Approved.
And then I would make a motion to approve the items that were discussed at the Finance Subcommittee, which would be to approve the position of Juris Doctor degree within the Appendix A and have that position eligible with respect to the salary schedule that is currently in place with regard to the doctoral column of said Appendix A of the contract, as well as adopting the school nurse level of differential with respect to Appendix E, having that differential effective as to the 31 nurses, as well as the position of tennis coaches for both boys and girls, having those positions be a part of Appendix B of the contract and be compensated as other spring season head coaching positions currently are, according to that said Appendix B.
So we'll call that the motion, essentially approving changes in some contract language regarding Juris Doctors, nurses, and tennis coaches, to summarize it.
Correct.
So motion's been made, properly seconded to approve those changes. All in favor? And they are approved. That do it?
That'll do it.
Okay. How about anyone else under new business?
The boys football team, varsity football team. Yep. They had a very good win against Newton North, and I believe it was 38-9. So that's a very nice win. The play calls were excellent, a great variety of calls. The unfortunate outcome of the game was that our quarterback, Matt Caruso, was hurt. And is now out for the season, unfortunately. But the backup quarterback did a great job of finishing the game and did quite well. So this Friday night, we'll be playing BC High. Again, a very good team. But I think that the Boxers have every shot at winning this game. And a shout out to the band and the dancers and cheerleaders. They did a great job with regard to the halftime show, as usual. I think the Newton North side of the field was very impressed with the production, because that's what it is. It's a major production, and it was excellent. So
it was the leather.
On the road again.
On the road at Boston College
at BCI up in Dorchester.
Friday night, 7 o'clock.
There was a note, an email sent to Principal Wolder from a Newton North alumni and fan, and saying those very words, that they were just completely impressed with the show that was put on Saturday.
Amazed me is they didn't have a band of their own, which they didn't have a marching band that day. I don't know if they do or not, but the Brockton, you know, band and show was just phenomenal, you know. So very well orchestrated, as usual.
Yeah, well, they're always good, and they get better as the season goes on. Yep. So good luck to the Boxers Friday night. I'll just mention real quickly, in a new business, I visited the Huntington School last Friday and read to a kindergarten class, and then toured some of our SCI classes, a kindergarten, second, fourth grade class. And it might be an old building, but there's great work being done in that school. It's really a really, really special place. We stayed a lot longer than we planned, but we had a great experience. And then, what was that at the Barrett Russell? Was that yesterday? Halloween, yeah. And I went for the Halloween parade at the Barrett Russell yesterday. So 245-year-olds in their Halloween costumes. And my job was to help keep them moving down the line just in a row. And that was absolutely a blast, and a lot of parents turned out for it. And every year there are always some parents that are reluctant to send their 5-year-old to the Barrett Russell. And every single time, by this time of the year, they now realize the best thing they could have possibly done was send their 5-year-old to the Barrett Russell, because it's a just a really unique school, to be just a kindergarten-only school, and with teachers and aides and staff that are doing a great job over there. And I remember what that school looked like about 10 years ago, and it's amazing. The work that's been done in there, it's really nice.
It brought life to that neighborhood.
It did. And the neighborhood loves having the school there. So I want to thank everyone at both schools that welcomed us in, and we had a great time. Anyone else? New business? Joyce.
I just wanted to mention that BHS had their elections for class of 2018 and class of 2019. So I just wanted to congratulate some of the new officers that are coming in. Class of 2018, President, bear with me with some of the names, Alexia Montero, Vice President Nina Fontes, Treasurer Ashley Fan, Secretary Ariana Ribeiro. Class of 2019 officers, we have President Minthia Gongpala, Vice President is Jayla Smith, Treasurer Tanisha Barros, and Secretary Ariana Abreu. Congratulations, and looking forward to seeing what these officers are going to do as far as representing their school.
Congratulations. I guess we should remind everyone again, too, that schools are closed next Tuesday for the presidential election. So remember that.
Go out and vote.
Two days off next week, Tuesday and Friday.
Yeah.
Mr. D'Agostino.
First, I want to mirror your comments about the Huntington School. I spent some time there not too long ago myself with our new principal, Ms. O'Brien, and we toured classrooms. I get to meet some of the students and teachers, and it's a very impressive place.
Yeah.
This past Friday, the Kennedy School PAC held their annual Halloween celebration, and it was packed. It was very, very successful, so I just wanted to congratulate the PAC and all the volunteers they had on putting on a great event.
Was it the evening, Mr. D'Agostino?
I'm sorry?
Evening event?
Yes. Yeah, on Friday evening.
So a lot of parents were there.
Yeah, a lot of parents there, a lot of kids there. It was really a great event, and brought my son and my wife and my father-in-law, who was in town, and we enjoyed it as well. So it was a great event.
Awesome.
Over at the Hancock is the spaghetti supper. It's a big fundraiser. It raises money for the Children's Helping
Hand
Fund.
This Friday night, this week?
This Friday night.
Okay. Yep. What time is that?
Coming up. It's at 5 o'clock. But there's a couple of seatings. There's one at 5, and then there's a seating at 6. So, I mean,
okay.
As long as you get there before 6:30, then you'll be fine. But there's always a very extensive list of donations where you can buy, you know, tickets and put them in the pot, and hopefully you'll pull what you want. But I mean, the main night is to raise, like I said, funds for the Children's Helping Hand Fund, which is helping needy children at the at that school. You know, who may need, you know, a winter coat or sneakers or, you know, clothes or, you know, whatever a child's needs might be that a teacher in the school or counselor, you know, identifies as a, you know, someone that needs a little help, you know, in a quiet way, they meet those needs. So it's a fun night, really. I mean, the parents love it. The kids go crazy when they win a good prize, you know. You know, I do criticize the pack because they call it a spaghetti supper, but it's ziti. I'm like, this is a, I'm like, I don't know about you, but you know, no Italian's going to call ziti spaghetti. So, you know, but whatever. So
it's easy to
it
eat.
It should be called the pasta supper, but they insist on calling it the spaghetti supper. But
yeah.
But they're well-intentioned people.
Yeah.
So, so it's a fun night. It's always a fun night.
All right. Anybody else under new business? All right. How about a motion to adjourn? Second, all in favor? Approved. This meeting is adjourned.